Bless you all to the Christian Television Network. Keep up the great work.
Hello and welcome back to Time of Refreshing. I'm your host, James Cleveland Jones, and guess what? You're in the right place at the right time. But I tell you the same thing every time you tune in. Pick up your phone, call your friends, call your family, call your loved ones, even call those who call themselves your enemies and let them know that TOR, that's right, Time of Refreshing, we're on the air and we're here to lift up, to magnify the name of the Most High God, who is Jesus the Christ. Listen, I'm excited because I get to spend this time with you, and you're going to be blessed, better than blessed on tonight's show. I've got an amazing guest with me. A while back, I had a chance to go over to Germany. As some of you know, I spent 21 years in the military, and my last 8 years were over in Europe. I spent 4 years in England and 4 years in Germany. And just recently, I had the chance to go back to celebrate with my bishop at the time and my pastor at that time, who was still serving there. He celebrated his 20th anniversary as being pastor there. And I had a chance to sit down with him and to interview him and just talk with him about some great things. And you're going to be blessed by this man of God. I want you to just sit back and enjoy it because he has so much knowledge that he wants to give to you. So you're going to be blessed by this. Thank you so much for tuning in. We'll see you.
Hello and welcome back. Listen, I'm sitting here in the great country of Germany in the city of Ramstein. I'm here because I'm part of the group that's celebrating 20 years of ministry right here with the man who God has spoken to just cover this area. I'm sitting with the one, the only, Bishop J. Allen Neal, and I'm excited about it. And I'll let him talk for himself. Bishop, God bless you. Thank you, sir.
God bless you, my friend. Good to see you again.
Thank you so much for being on
our
show today.
Yeah.
I do this with every guest. Tell the world, who is Bishop J. Allen Neal?
Well, I think first I would say just a man of God, a husband, father, grandfather, and I guess a pastor of pastors and a lover of golf and the Dallas Cowboys.
You got me when you said the Dallas Cowboys, because we're on the same team with that, Bishop. Listen, I'm excited because I love what you're doing here in ministry.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get to be this place where you are now? You've been serving here for 20 years in Germany. How did that happen?
Well, it really wasn't by design. I was an Army officer, as you well know, and I came to Europe. I had a plan to, you know, MBA and all of that. I was going to open some McDonald's franchises, and I had commanded so many times in the military and really understood what it would take to do that and be successful, and I was wanting to have a couple for each one of my kids, each one of my grandkids. But I was involved in some teaching, and the Lord gave me an opportunity to start a ministry. It was not a start. I was in a chapel situation, and they didn't have a charismatic or Pentecostal chaplain, and they asked me to serve it. 30 people, women and children. 20 years later, it's over a couple of thousand churches in 13 countries and 4 continents. So God has really blessed us tremendously. So I didn't ever dream, wake up and, you know, say, I want to be a preacher. Matter of fact, my wife never wanted to marry one. So it's been an interesting trail.
That's fantastic. I'm excited because I tell you, there's so much that you do for the kingdom, and I'm excited about that. Let's just talk about your ministry here at Agape.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about the ministry Agape here.
Well, one of the things that the Lord showed me that we really needed to do was try to mirror the scriptures as worship. And one of the things, you know, as you were my worship leader, you know, we have we were just sharing just the other day, many people were not of color would not come to our church initially because they said we sung white music.
Now, you know, mean,
well, they didn't understand the expression of worship.
Amen.
You know, 20 years ago, we were, you know, when you go to church, people are so used to choirs and that sort of thing. But we ushered in an era, I believe, here that you were the choir, and just trying to get people into the presence of the Lord, teaching humility,
yes,
unity, and service, and trying to get people to understand what the great commandment was all about and missions and taking the gospel to the world. So that's basically what Agape is about. It's about really teaching people humility, unity, and service, and understanding how to serve, and really trying to deal with people where they are. I always say I'm not trying to build a big church, but I am trying to build big people. And I think many people have a hard time with their pastor being the keeper of their soul.
Come on.
And if I'm the keeper of your soul, that means your mind, your emotions, your intellect. I really need to know what you're thinking. And how can I do that unless I'm the one that is applying those things and bringing answers to real difficult questions and weighty questions yes. that many people just say, well, you know, the church shouldn't do that. But I think we have to be involved because Jesus, if he's Lord of one thing, he's Lord of everything, and he's got to be Lord of all. That's the way I see it.
Absolutely. Now, for me, when I think of you, Bishop, I think of you as being a leader's leader.
Thank you.
How would you define leadership? Because there's so many people out there that have a desire to lead, or they think that they're leaders, but they're not very effective.
Well, here's one of the things that I learned many years ago. I think that the misnomer with people, they think they can motivate. And I think what we have to do is set an atmosphere for accomplishment. I always say that if I took a shark and put it like in this area, maybe half of the sanctuary or quarter of the sanctuary, it would only grow to a certain size. But if I take that same shark and released it to the ocean, it would grow to its full potential. And what I try to do with people is not trying to dictate mode. Everybody's not going to be the same. I understand that if I can get, if you're a 75%er and let's say my daughter's 100%er, you know, I want her to come with 100% every time. Absolutely. You come with 80% every time. I'm not trying to make you do 80% because you're not there. That's not where you are. I think if we can get people to maximize where they are, and you can't motivate them, but you have to set an atmosphere and this trust factor to get them to be all they can be, basically. It's still an old Army slogan.
Man, that's awesome. One of the things that I remember you said, Bishop, that I still believe and I live by today, and I'd like you to elaborate on this if you can. You said once that you never really know who a person is until you've had your first disagreement.
Well, you know, I call it a meeting engagement. What I say is, you know, everybody can praise God when they got a bologna sandwich up under their arm. You know what I mean? They got everything going on. They can praise the Lord. But it's not until you have what I call that meeting engagement, that first encounter where we see where we are. Yes. Because I think disagreement is everything. You know, as I travel the world, one of the things that's interesting, my favorite flower to see is a rose. I love a rose. But, you know, a rose is not a rose without a thorn.
Come on.
So many people, I mean, let's just face it. A rose without a thorn is some kind of hybrid something, you know, and it's not real. You have to, in a relationship, I think, if you're building trust. I love what Stephen Covey talks about, the speed of trust. Mm-hmm. You can't get into that trust thing until we get into the conflict. What are we going to do when the bullets start flying? What are we going to do when things get rough? What are we going to do when conflict happens? I think that's when I find out who's ready for prime time in leadership. That's what I look at.
So those people that are trying to avoid conflict, you tell them they need to actually get in there.
Oh, yes. I want to know right up front. See, if I know early how you respond under pressure.
I love that.
See,
I love that.
Because pressure's coming.
It's coming.
But I need to know. That's why the military, for instance, I spent a greater part of 20 years training for a war that lasted 100 hours.
Mm. Wow.
I mean, it's amazing. And we had to make realistic that training. So when the bombs were going off, when folks were shooting, you were familiar with the helicopters moving, the jets doing, you know, but if it's my first time, you know, I'm freaking out. You know, I've got to change my diapers, you know?
I love that vision. Let's get ready to take a break, and when we come back, I want to just elaborate on something you just said there, because I thought about something else that you also said. Preparation is never lost time. So when we come back from my break, I want you to take a moment and just elaborate on that.
We'll do it.
Listen, we'll be back in just a minute. Don't touch that dial. You need to hear what this bishop, this man of God is saying. We'll see you in just a minute.
Put your hands together tonight. Come on. I need the praises to make some noise.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord sing.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord.
Sound the alarm to our Most High God.
Praise the Lord.
Come on. Praise Him for His excellence.
excellent greatness.
Praise Him for His excellent greatness.
With the cymbals and string instruments. Praise the Lord. We'll praise in a dance,
yes. Just like David, we'll praise in a dance.
Praise Him with lifting and clapping of hands.
Praise the Lord, oh, praise the Lord.
Bow down before You in majesty.
Bow down before You in majesty.
We declare Your name is holy.
Praise the Lord, oh, praise the Lord.
Let everything that happens.
Back, and I'm sitting with Bishop J. Allen Neal. I'm excited because he's got so much that God is doing through him and through him, and we're just talking about some of the things, some of the words of wisdom that he shared while I was under the ministry, and I'm excited about that. And we just left off talking about preparation not being lost time.
Oh, I love that. I always say preparation is never lost time. I mean, and I get that from my military days. Like I said, we trained 20 years to fight 100 hours. I just really believe that if you prepare yourself. I always say the opportunity of a lifetime has got to be achieved in the lifetime of the opportunity. And so if you're not prepared when it comes, you know, it's gone. And seasons will pass and may not ever come again. So that's what I always want to make people prepare. Just preparedness is just so important.
Fantastic. Now, one of the things I love about your ministry is that missions is so important to
you.
Tell us about the mission.
Well, you know, God has blessed us to do some tremendous work around the world. We got into missions just, it wasn't, again, on purpose. We were having a praise and worship service, one of our services that we have, High Praise and Worship, and a man from Sri Lanka walks into service. You know, he was kind of going around and asking what kind of church is this, and one of the deacons said, give me your keys, which started our parking lot ministry, by the way.
Awesome.
Give me your keys. And this valet, and we'll take it, we'll take your stuff, and we'll bring it to you, trust me. And he came into the service, and he fell down in the midst of praise and worship. 15 years later, we have really changed a nation. We got in part of Sri Lanka in the northern part some 15, 16 years ago. War was going on, the civil war was there going on, and there was a people group called the Tamils that were in a bad shape. And we got in there and said, listen, we're going to just take care of widows and orphans. That led to opening up schools. We opened up, first, an orphanage. We're taking care of several hundred kids. That went from building churches. We built 8 from the ground up, bigger than this, actually, and another 24 we helped complete. And then the organization just really tried to start, really rapidly grew. Then we had the big tsunami. Yes. We took about $300,000 of aid in there. Interesting enough, I was able to get in to talk with the Tamil Tigers. Many people who are Sri Lankans that may be even watching this now, yes, I've been to probably more places in your country than you have. And it's kind of interesting because we've got to travel in all of the places that, yes, most people won't go. But we got into that, and God just began to allow that to expand. We really felt like the mantra that I received when I was serving Bishop Morton years ago, this changing of a generation, I really took that serious. And I really kind of believe that, you know, the children of Israel left Egypt, but they don't take their children back to Egypt to educate them. Only ill-advised and simple Christians do that. It's called public school. We're responsible, really, yes, for training our kids. And I just felt like that's what we had to do. And now I just went back with Bishop Valley, who, yes, you were talking with. We went back. I was able to ordain some 30 kids. Wow. That were kids years ago, 5, 10, 15 years. Now there are, 20, 25, some of them 30 years old, pastors and ministers. It was a wonderful time to see what we've done. I mean, in that process, we followed understanding economics. We have a hotel, actually. Wow. It's called Agape Hotel. On, you can go to booking.com and just put in Agape, amen, Hotel in Sri Lanka. And what we've done is been able to, let them, you can provide fish, yes, or you can teach them to fish. And this is a part of our economic development kind of thing, to give them work and be able to keep that money inside. And we've also now started a series of learning centers. We learned it after my sixth grade teacher. It's called the Virginia H. French Learning Centers. And what we're doing is trying to teach kids in third world country English and computer technology. And so we're hoping to get, we've got 3 now, we're hoping to get 10 here in the next 2 years, that we'll be able to train some 1,000 kids a year. And it's really good. I mean, you can have a doctor's degree, but if you don't know English, that's in a third world country, you're not gonna do very well. And so some of these call centers and that sort of thing, we're trying to get our kids as proficient as possible to be able to tap into that. And so that's what our mission really is all about, is really trying to do that. We are, in India. We have several churches in India, a couple of homes in India. When I say several churches, I say thousands of churches in India. God has blessed us to really kind of now partner with a major organization there, the Christian Evangelical Fellowship of India. And so, with the university, the Bible university and colleges that we have, that we're able to do a lot more even now for our clergy. So, missions for me is everything. I just really believe that God said, take the gospel, yes, to the uttermost parts of the world. And I've always said, I preached a message years ago, the church has a withered hand. And one of the things about that message, when Jesus healed the man with the withered hand, it's interesting. You can take the hand and you can figure out there's an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. But the problem is we've got bishops on every corner. If we had bishops on every corner and the church is in trouble, let's say this. Let's say if we had police on every corner and the crime rate went up, you would think the police are on the take.
Come on.
Or the criminals are very bad. I think when I look at so many, the proliferation of bishops,
yes,
and the church still got so much hell in it.
Come on.
Well, I believe the bishops are not really doing what they really should be doing. I think we really need to get to a place where bishops are really kind of really doing in a really apostolic ministry. Yes. Next is this, this whole thing about the prophetic word is really now. I really believe God is really speaking to us,
yes,
and we really need to hear the voice of God and really take the gospel to the world.
Yes.
And I always said that in that particular message, I said that most churches and most of you who are listening to me in the West, I will tell you, and you're in a church, I'll challenge you, your light bills in many of your churches and your utility bills far outweigh your mission. If I, as an MBA, if I were to look, I can look at anybody's financials if I looked at financials and looked at expense sheets and I saw a lot of chicken, I think it's Kentucky Chicken. It could be Chick-fil-A. If I saw a lot of hamburger, it could be, but what do I see when I look at the church's financials? I can't even tell it's a church. That's the problem. Wow. Jesus said, where your treasure is, that's where your heart should be also. Yes, I'm not trying to condemn anybody. Just check your church's financials. That's all I say.
Bishop, you just said a mouthful. I tell you, I've only got 1 minute left.
Yes, sir.
But I definitely want to get you back because I love what your message is, not only to you overseas, but I'm speaking to stateside as well. Take a moment. Take this last minute and just say something to the listening audience.
I just want to say to you all that, you know, I really believe that we're in a wonderful state right now. Right now, I believe what we're doing right now in America, I want to tell you, if you can remember this, thereconciledchurch.org. I believe right now what Bishop Harry Jackson, Bishop T.D. Jakes, and James Robinson are doing, pulling church leaders from around the country to come together on this issue of race and really speak to seven bridges of peace. I believe that this is going to be a move of God that's really going to impact America in a lot of ways, economically, education, to really kind of deal with our criminal justice system and those sorts of things. I just beseech pastors really to say that this is the time that we hear Jesus' prayer, his high priestly prayer in John 17, let us be one. We need to be one as the church of the living God.
Bishop, thank you so very much.
My friend.
You've got Bishop's information on the screen. Please call this man. You need to have him in your church because he's got a message from God.
God bless you,
love
sir.
You, Bishop. Thank you so
man.
Much. God bless you. We'll All right. see you again soon.
All right.
God bless you. Bye-bye.
Anybody ever thought back of how you made it out, all the things that were binding you?